Penguin Random House Audio presents Swimming Home by Mary Rose MacColl. Read for you by Saskia Maarleveld.
For Andre MacColl. New York Daily News, August 19th, 1925. Fairer sex fails fathoms. American swimmer Miss Gertrude Ederle has been taken unconscious from the icy waters of the English Channel, which have proven more than a match for even the strongest female swimmers of the world. Miss Ederle, 18, of Amsterdam Avenue, New York, has been training for the Channel swim since her triumphant return from the Olympic Games of Paris, 1924. She set out from France in the early hours of Wednesday and battled rain, fog, shifting tides, and freezing temperatures. She was pulled from the water after 9 hours by her coach, experienced distance swimmer Mr. Jabez Wolfe, just over halfway across from France to the English shore. Miss Ederle swims with the Women's Swimming Association in New York, which produced the swimmers that saw America triumphant in the Olympics, winning more Olympic medals in the water than any other nation, with most won by the women swimmers. But English swim coach Sir Michael Brosley said he'd seen no evidence in swimmers like Miss Ederle or British swimmer Mercedes Glites, also a Channel contender, of the kind of stamina required.
"If women think they can swim the English Channel, then let's find one who can actually do it," Sir Michael said. "I think you'll find that these two are the strongest of them, and they are not up to the task, nor ever will be."
Thursday Island, Australia, June 1924. The sand was so hot it burned the soles of her feet. Catherine moved to her toes to relieve the tender middle parts of her feet, back to her heels to relieve her toes, jumped from one foot to the other, watched the sunlight on the sea until it hurt her eyes, sucked hard on her bottom lip. The heat came up toward her, making the water shimmer and wobble to her eyes. She breathed it in. When finally Michael yelled, "Go!" she wasn't ready. Oh, but the relief of it when her feet first hit the water. They stung with cold, and it was delicious. Michael was in front of her at first, but she was those inches taller, and she caught him up when the water got to thigh height and tackled him. They both went under. She came up to swim, but he'd wormed out of her grasp and had disappeared. When he came up, he was ahead again. "Bid," she muttered to herself, his islander name. It meant dolphin. They swam out to the reef, the farthest reef from the shore, where they'd first seen the turtles, two of them. They dived down to the rocks together.
"The big one, he'd be 100, I reckon," Catherine said when they came back up.
"At least," Michael said. "Big fella."
"They don't harm anything," she said.
"I should tell the Walton boys," he said, grinning.
The Walton boys liked killing things.
"Don't you dare," she said. "Did you notice the other one is back today? The smaller one. Did you see?"
He nodded and then whipped his bangs back off his face, the water flicking off his black curls.
"You think that's his woman?"
His skin shone dark, his blue eyes on fire.
"Do turtles have women?"
"There are turtles, Whoppy."
Her name on the island, Whoppy, for fish.
"I think it could be worse than to be a turtle, don't you?"
"Except when the fishermen are coming."
"Yes, except for that. But they look..."
"What?"
"Like we're meant to look." "Come on, I'll race you to the shore."
She dived under and started swimming. Part 1. London, August 1925. Chapter 1. Louisa Quick emerged into a morning as joyous as London offered. Prince's Square was wearing summer finally, this late in August, almost as if the strange wintry weather of these last few weeks had never happened. The still wet pavement glistened in the sunlight. There were birds. Louisa had no idea where they'd been until today. Her life seemed unimportant suddenly, the waiting room full of patients, the mountain of paperwork in the office, the grumbling nursing staff, all of it gone. Louisa might skip, she thought, or dance a jig in weather like this. Well, someone else might skip or dance a jig. Normally, Louisa wouldn't even be outside at this time of morning. She'd be inside, working. Where I would be still, she thought, if it weren't for Helen Anderson. Louisa had been in the treatment area off the waiting room with a patient when the front desk nurse parted the curtains and told her she was wanted on the telephone. Can I call them back? Louisa had said. The nurse shook her head. They said it was urgent, doctor. From the surgery or here? Louisa had said. The nurse didn't know. It was terrible to admit, but Louisa would hurry more for a patient from her surgery in Harley Street. It was a simple equation. The Harley Street patients paid and expected more. Louisa needed their money for her work here at the clinic. She left her patient with the nurse to finish up and went to take the call. The caller was Helen Anderson, a patient who'd come to the surgery 2 years before. Louisa couldn't remember what had been the matter with her, only that she was one of those patients who knew more than her doctor and wouldn't do as she was told. Louisa had seen her again just before Catherine started at the Henley School in the spring, but Helen, the school's principal, didn't acknowledge their history. Sometimes patients didn't want to see their doctors in other settings, and who could blame them? When Louisa asked on the telephone now if she was all right, Helen sounded exasperated. Of course, she spluttered. But you must come quickly. Write down the address. Louisa scribbled down an address as ordered. She was about to ask if anything had happened to Catherine when Helen Anderson hung up. What the devil could be wrong? Louisa had thought. It had been a tumor, Louisa recalled. Abdominal, large. Perhaps it had regrown. Louisa hurried through the lane to the Ratcliffe Highway and put her hand out to signal a passing taxi cab. As the driver pulled over, she realized she'd forgotten her hat and coat. She must look a fright. Her dark brown hair, the armory of pins it took to secure it. She really needed a cut. Adding to the view she was fairly confident others experienced of her, a woman of difficult to determine age, a little addled by life. 41, she'd tell anyone who asked. I'm really only 41, although everyone thinks I'm 100. And I'm not addled, just busy. At least she'd taken off the stained pinafore she'd been wearing. She'd had to dress a nasty head wound earlier, and the apron was still covered in blood.
Why are you going down there, ma'am?
The driver said, tapping the piece of paper she'd handed him. I'm a doctor, she said. The driver turned around and looked at her with raised eyebrows, but said no more. Louisa rarely took taxicabs, mostly walked where she needed to go. But she didn't have time today. What the devil was the problem with Helen Anderson, she wondered. Brusque. That was how Louisa's colleague and friend Ruth Luxton had described Louisa. Sometimes, Louisa, you can be brusque. Ruth said Louisa needed a holiday. She and Ruth were both working too hard, truth be told, keeping the clinic running with the money they earned from their Harley Street practices. Louisa had upset one of the nurses, Ruth said. The girl had handed Louisa a swab when she'd asked for something else. She wasn't brusque. She was busy, she told Ruth. Still, Louisa went and apologized to the girl. She wished they were a bit tougher, these nurses. And yes, she wished she hadn't been brusque. Prince's Square still had the stateliness of the Grand London dock years, but it was a tired stateliness now more than anything, visited regularly by the reek of burned sugar from the refineries, combined with the rich smell of ale from the inn that now graced the opposite corner of the square. The clinic, which both Ruth and Louisa insisted was run on Nightingale principles, was spotless inside, or as spotless as the nurses and orderlies could make it. But it was, Louisa knew, in need of maintenance. And now, the health inspector of Greater London was planning a visit, they'd just been informed. Louisa had read through the list of facilities all medical institutions were supposed to provide. Prince's Square had hardly any of them. Of course, if they weren't there, the poor of London's East would have nothing in terms of healthcare. But that seemed to matter little to the new inspectorate. The driver turned into John Street. Ratcliffe will be faster.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.